I built an entire API for the project in my upcoming React course, Project React. But if you look at it a little bit closer, it's not actually what it seems. So over here, I have the project currently running that we're going to be building in Project React. And here we are in module 3 in step 3, as you can see over here. This is the step where we implement the first version of data fetching in the project. So what you're seeing over here, these are all listings that are fetched from the API in the project. If I press search over here, which is going to trigger a new fetch, you see a loading indicator, and then we have the listings showing up over here. If I can type something here, for example, Paris, we can type and we can search, and we're only going to get listings that are labeled as Paris. The thing is, if I open up now my console in the browser over here, and I go to the network tab, right, and I select here only fetch slash XHR, which is only going to show up fetch requests, every time that I press search over here, we are getting some data, but no fetch request is actually going on. Furthermore, if I actually reload this entire page, you're going to see that things are happening, but anything that is labeled fetch slash XHR is not showing up. I can press search as many times as I want, and we're not seeing any fetch requests happening. Why? This is the code that's currently running the screen that you're seeing. So we have here the homepage. This is the homepage component. And we have some state here for the listings, first loading, errors, and the filters. And then we have this use effect over here, which handles the fetching. So yes, in this course, at this point, we are doing the fetch with use effect. There is a valid reason for that, which I go over that in the course. But in part 2, in Project React Extended, we are actually going to be changing this to using React Query. So I don't want to hear anybody saying that, why are we fetching data with use effect? Trust me, there's a reason, and we go over that in the course. So as you can see, we have this fetch listings function here inside of this use effect that is sending a request over here using api.get to slash api slash listings. It's passing the filters as parameters and the abort controller signal as a signal to be able to abort the request. This API over here is directly wrapping Axios, which is a very popular data fetching library. So this is doing a real fetch request. Yet, if we go on the network tab, every time that we press search, nothing is showing up here. What's going on? Let's try to add a console log here right before we set the listings and log this response and see what it gives us, right? So we can do console.log and then response and see what happens in the console. Then we're going to go back to the application. We're going to go here to the console. And this is the response that we have. This is an object. And this is your typical Axios response, right? You have the status over here, status 200. You have the configuration, which is all the configuration that was set for this specific URL. For example, the base URL, the headers, and so on. And you also have the data here, which contains all of our listings. This is what we're seeing on the screen over here. This is a real Axios response. So this is a real fetch request, but on the network tab, once again, every time that we do it, we're not seeing anything. Well, let's now go back and investigate this API over here. So this API is defined at the top of the file. It is imported from slash API. And let's go here and see what this is. So this is the API over here. This creates a base Axios instance, right? It's using axios.create, which essentially allows you to easily create an instance of Axios and set some configurations to it. For example, we're setting the base URL so that any request that uses this API is automatically going to get this base URL, which is coming from our environment. But over here, if you look just a little bit below, we can see that the API is actually being used in this mock adapter class over here. So we have this API, right? It's being used here in this mock adapter class, also with a delayed response, a simulated delayed response of 1 second. This mock adapter is coming from this library over here, the Axios mock adapter library. And this is why we're not seeing anything in the network tab. What this is doing is this is actually mocking every single request and it's intercepting the request before it hits an endpoint and returning data before that. And the reason for that is that in this project, there is no actual backend. All of the data and all fetch requests are mocked and they never hit a real endpoint. They all return local data that is defined within this folder, within this API folder. So it's over here, it's inside of SRC API. Inside of this data folder here, we have all of the data available in the project. And this is what these functions are returning. They're not hitting a real endpoint. They're returning local data that is actually stored in local storage through these files over here. So this is what you're seeing over here, right, we have this file, this index.js inside of the API folder. This is creating this adapter here, this Axios mock adapter. And then for every request that actually makes sense and matters for the project, we are mocking it, right? This is the request that gets a single listing. It listens to this endpoint, which is regex for just API slash listings slash the listing ID. And then we're actually getting the ID from over here, and then we're getting the listing by ID. And if we don't have a listing, if the ID is invalid, we're returning an Axios response. Status code 404, message listing not found. If we do have a listing, then we're getting the location of a listing by using listing.locationID and then get location by ID. And then if we don't have a location, we're also returning an Axios response with a status code 404 and message location not found. And finally, if we have both a listing and a location, we're returning this response status 200 listing and then the location in the object of the listing. But these functions here, although this looks exactly like a real fetch request, a real backend, if we go here to get listing by ID, this is actually getting a database table, sure, listings, but if you go here to the definition of get database table, this is a function that uses the get item function, passes the environment.db key, database key, but this get item is coming from lib/utils/localStorage. If I open up this get item over here, this is just doing window.localStorage.getItem, and it's trying to return the item that is stored in the local storage. If it is, it's returning it here. And then we're using it inside of this function, get listing by ID. If we have a listing, we're just looking in those listings, finding the one that has the ID that matches. And then we're returning that listing over here. Nothing is actually being fetched from a backend. Everything is mocked and everything is returned on the client through local storage. And that's why whenever we go here and we press search and we do anything, we are seeing data. We are seeing an actual Axios response log to the console that looks and feels exactly like a real one, because for all that matters, it is a real one, but the actual data is not coming from a backend. Everything is mocked. The result of this is that this is going to work exactly as if it was a real fetch request. The only thing that is different, and really this is the only thing, is that the data isn't actually retrieved from an endpoint, but from these functions over here. That's it. And even though this code runs entirely on the client, so on the front end, technically, this code is exactly like the code that you would see in a real backend, right? So first we're checking if the user is authenticated using this with auth over here. If I go to the definition, we're basically checking the token in the config.headers like you would in a real fetch request. Then we're verifying the token. And if the user is not authenticated, we're returning a response that says 403 unauthorized, right? This is exactly the same thing you would have in a real backend. Also, then we're fetching the listing, and if we don't have a listing, we're returning 404 not found, again the same. If we don't have a location, 404 not found, again the same. And if we do, we're returning 200, and then the actual listing with the location, exactly as if this was a real backend. Now, the reason why this was done this way, and the reason why I chose to implement it this way for the course, is that as a front-end developer who's just learning React, who's just starting out in React, you don't have to manage all of this yourself. You don't have to set up your entire backend and manage your own database and set up and configure all of your endpoints. This is all managed for you. Instead, you can focus on what really matters, which is actually learning React and learning how to use these endpoints. And this also, by the way, simulates having a real React Junior developer job where you wouldn't really be expected to build an entire endpoint as you start, but rather you would be expected to be able to use it and to fetch data from it. This is designed to make it easy for you to learn React and to start building something cool with it without overwhelming you with an entire backend and database that you have to manage all by yourself. And then as you progress through the course and you progress through all the different modules and become better with React, you can go back to this code and look at all of it and learn from it. This is great code. As I said, this code is exactly like what you would find in a real backend, and there's a ton to learn over here. This is how the entire backend, the mock API, is set up in the project, and everything is also well documented to make it as easy for you as possible to learn and to get value from it. Because the whole point of this course is not to just teach you what to do and to just show you what to do and to just give you like instructions to follow, but rather to teach you the fundamental concepts and understand why you want to do certain things, right? That's why I'm making this video, to explain and to go over this API, because I feel that this is really important. And then I documented everything so that you can always go to this and always refer to this and get the most value out of this course, and not just see what to do, but also understand why things are done this way, and you get a lot more from it that way. And you're free to dive into this as deep as you want and to go over as many files and code as you want. There's a lot of files in here that we don't have you built directly, but actually are already there so that you can focus once again on what matters. But the code is yours, and when you're ready, when you feel up for it, go and look at it and learn as much as you can. But the thing is, even though all of this is mocked, even though this entire API is mocked, from your perspective, which is again the front-end developer, you are calling and using Axios directly exactly as if you would if this wasn't mocked, right? You're doing api.get and then passing an endpoint and passing all of these configurations over here. This is exactly the same thing if this wasn't mocked. So from your perspective, you're actually getting the best of both worlds. You're getting the real fetch request experience without all of the work and overwhelmingness of actually implementing all of the backend yourself. Right, not only are we doing this, but we're also handling loading states, so we're setting loading to true and then handling error states as well. We're doing a try-catch block and seeing if we have an error, and we're also preventing race conditions with Axios and doing request cancellation. These are all things that you would have to do either manually if you're doing this through useEffect, or that React Query is doing for you if this was a real fetch request. And in Project React Extended, which again is part two of this entire course, when we actually port all of this over to React Query, this is going to work exactly the same way, even if the API and the entire backend is mocked. This was done by design. The end result is that you have a fully functional application with a backend that you can fetch data from, and you can handle loading and error states, race conditions, exactly in the same way as if this was a real backend. And from your perspective, you cannot tell the difference unless you look at the underlying code that is driving this entire thing. You can just focus on consuming the API safely and learning how to fetch React through that without worrying about all the difficult things. Once again, this was done by design, and this was done to make it the best learning experience for you possible. And really, that's kind of the general theme of this course. This course will have you build a real-world application in a way that is super accessible for a beginner. But at the same time, you will also learn advanced concepts in a way that you can actually understand them. And if that sounds like something that you'd like to try, then I invite you to go to cosden.solutions/projectreact and actually check out this waitlist over here and join it, right? This is going to be the best way to get all the information about the course, which is again coming out very, very soon. Honestly, if you ever wanted to learn React the correct way and really see how all the different pieces fit together in a real-world project that looks like this, then this is the only course that you can take. There is no other course like it, I promise you. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like these, you can make sure to leave this a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Cosden. This is Cosden Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.